we only reach 69%. So in order to save all that money by not having a long-form census, we spent $22 million for useless information.
Thank you. And we're going to go to a question, I believe it's the one in the back who had their hand up.
Thank you very much. My name is Rory Delaney, and Elizabeth, I agree with everything you said. And I've watched you fight to have a say in the Parliament of Atlanta. You know, which is terrible. But we, the people, we, the audience, stood by for 10 years and watched all this happen. What can we do? What can you do to stop us from being so complacent?
Diminishment
1 second and just let everyone know that I'm not sure how many questions we're going to be able to get to this evening. If we will end at 8:30 just because we want to respect everyone's time. But if we don't get to your question tonight, we will find answers for you. We'll get your answers afterwards. Go ahead.
My daughter just gave me the hand sign. Mommy, shorter answers.
Good evening. My name is Natasha. Now, I've heard this answer before, but I'd love to hear it expand upon by our review. How is voting green not splitting the vote in Canada?
Okay, our problem in Canada, really quickly, isn't vote splitting. As a matter of fact, if there had been no Greens on the ballot at all in 2011, it wouldn't have affected the result at all, except that Carrie Lund would still be the member of Parliament for Saskatchewan Parliament. The reality is that the big challenge in Canada is vote abandoning, not vote splitting. The largest voting bloc in Canada the last few elections, 40% of Canadian voters, the people who stayed home. So there's what my daughter calls truthiness around this idea. You think, well, there's people and there's... The reality of Greens is we increase voter turnout. On Vancouver Island, in particular, nobody should be worried about vote splitting, because what's the notion here? We've got no chance of a Conservative winning in Victoria, and we're still told we might split the vote. In Saskatchewan Islands, I get people saying to me, I voted for you last time, I think you're great, but this time I really have to stop Stephen Harper, so I have to vote strategically. I'm afraid that the messaging around vote splitting, as well-intentioned as it will be, and I say, I love people in many of the groups that are trying to make people worry. Fear not, I say this in the church, fear not.
A lot. And I know why I'm working hard, but some days I am
sound the way we used to run democracy. To make sure that Magna Carta is being worked on and not attacked. It needs to grow, but it doesn't need to become more oppressing. You know, it needs to be like, there's a law that has to be built back into the Magna Carta.
Thank you. There was a two-part question there. The first part, I want to make sure I repeat to people, because everybody answered the questions. The first part was, how do we make sure these housing programs and this help for people, how do we make sure people can access it? Because there are hurdles and barriers. And I certainly work on those a lot for my constituency office. I have fantastic constituency office staff. We made up a new job description for people who work in my constituency office. I recommend it to Joanne for her constituency office. The people who work in my office are described as constituent advocates. They come through our door, we're there to help. Even if it's not federal jurisdiction, because quite often it's not, we don't send anyone away saying, oh, good luck, try it out there. We'll say, well, hang on with us until we get someone who will help you in that other office, which is where you should be. So we have to make sure that all these programs are really accessible. And that means empathy. That means understanding what it's like to be a single mom on welfare and not able to get your check and get through the end of the month. It means really putting yourself in the shoes of the person you're trying to help, which will change the way these programs roll out. Second question, Magna Carta. I'm so glad you raised it. The Right Honorable Joe Clark spoke at the invitation of the Green Party of Sandwich Gulf Islands, and some of you were there, in January of this year, at the invitation of the Green Party. Imagine that. Former progressive conservative prime minister spoke at a Green Party event. And he actually said that I was a great MP, which was nice. But the other thing he said, which is much more chilling, well, that wasn't chilling, that was nice. What he said was, given that Magna Carta celebrated an 800-year birthday, Magna Carta said that even the king did not have the power to act unilaterally. The king had to consult the commoners. That's where the House of Commons comes from. We are the commoners. Joe Clark said Stephen Harper is violating Magna Carta. I've never heard a stronger indictment ever, and we need to respect those basic principles that there is no such thing as unilateral power in a democracy. It doesn't vest itself in the monarch, and it sure as hell does not vest itself in the prime minister.
My name is Tom. I'd like to know what alternatives to first past the post you're proposing, and if you think instituting mandatory voting would be beneficial or detrimental.
Thank you, Tom. I'm sorry. The reason I feel so guilty because I gave two long answers. Okay, first of all, we want any form of proportional representation. The Green Party supports getting rid of first past the post because it's a perverse voting system, but we're not rigid on whether it's single transferable vote, mixed member proportional, or some other system. Personally, I think we should consult and have a referendum across Canada, but I would
options. Talk with us today. Actually, you don't have